Good morning, good morning. How are you guys doing today? You guys are doing well? I praise God that it's Saturday morning, amen? I know it's been a little bit of a crazy week for us. We were traveling, doing some traveling for our baby boy. And yesterday was my four-year anniversary. So I praise God for 4 years of marriage. 4 years of being refined and sanctified. And I look forward to the next 4 years, and the next 4 years, and the next 4 years. So 4 years of being married yesterday. It's been a while since I've been with you guys. Some of you guys look familiar. Other of you guys that have not yet gotten the chance to get to know you. It's probably been about 2 years since I've been with you guys. Is that correct? About 2 years more, maybe a little more. I know for sure it was before the pandemic. So a little has changed since I've seen you. A lot more than we would like to realize. But we are still here sitting this morning, isn't that right? And I praise God for that opportunity that we have to be able to still worship together as a church family, to be able to be here. I know that this is my first time being with this church at this location. The last time I was with you guys, it was at a different location. But beautiful place to worship here. And I know it's been definitely a blessing to be here. This morning, I'm going to be sharing a message that's titled differently than what's in your bulletin. So I would like to apologize for the hard work of those who put together a bulletin. This morning's message is titled, The Devil is a Schemer. The Devil is a Schemer. For those of you guys who don't know me, my name is Marco Topete. I am married. I have a wonderful, beautiful wife and a baby boy that's now 14 months old. And we have another on the way that's due in June. So we're playing catch up, having COVID babies. I wish that my wife could have been here. She sends her greetings. Our baby boy is starting to really get, how can I say this? Our baby boy is starting to really find his place in Sabbath school, in Cradle Roll. And so mommy likes to take him to Cradle Roll at our home church. He's starting to clap to the hands. He's starting to clap to the songs. He's starting to really get in tune with his Cradle Roll. So they chose Cradle Roll over Cap. Can you believe it? Yeah, you take it up with them next time you see them, okay? But I wish that she could have been here, and maybe next time they'll be with me when I come. I don't know, when was the last time you guys heard a message that focused on the devil? I feel that we don't at times think about it too much or speak about it much, but when we start to lose sense of who he is and the power that he has, not to glorify him in any way, but to realize that he is real, then sometimes we start to forget how real he is in our personal lives. And this morning's message, I pray, is a journey that we can have together and look at some characteristics that Paul warns us about in relation to the devil and his workings. And when I read and was reading this portion of scripture, one thing came to my mind that I couldn't shake, and it was how much of a schemer the devil truly is. And that's why that gave birth to this sermon that we're going to be listening today. So let's have a word of prayer, and we will begin with our Bible study this morning. You guys ready? Let's pray. Father in heaven, I pray that this sacred time that we have together would only serve to glorify and uplift you. Speak to our hearts, Father. Speak through your scripture. Allow us to get a glimpse of God this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. I've been walking now with the Lord this February for almost 10 years. Almost 10 years. How long has it been since some of you guys have been baptized? Who would like to share? How many years has it been, or months? 55 years since you got baptized. Amen. Anybody else? How many years has it been? About 18 years. 53 years of being baptized. It works! It works! Still here! It works! I'm coming up on 10 years this coming February 18th since I've been baptized. And I've had my share in my Christian experience of walking on spiritual clouds. And also I've had my fair share in my short experience of walking in low valleys. Isn't that right? Have you? On spiritual highs and spiritual deficiencies. I've had my moments where I really saw God answering my prayers, and also moments where God has kept silence. Have you guys had that before? I've had my moments of utter faith when I thought that all things were possible, and moments where I doubted everything about my walk with God. Maybe you've also can relate with what happens in the Christian journey. Maybe right now you're on a spiritual high and you're really seeing evidence of your faith and evidence of God's work, not just in your life, but in the life of those around you. Or maybe you are on the other spectrum. On the spectrum where this morning you're hoping and praying that whatever is said from the pulpit can feed your soul because you're feeling a little low. I have a message for all of us this morning, and it's the message that the devil is a schemer. I'm going to repeat that throughout this entire message because I want this to be ingrained that just when you think you know how the enemy works, we really have no idea. I'm going to be sharing 3 points with you guys. Our Bible study is going to be based on Ephesians chapter 6, if you'd like to go there. Ephesians chapter 6. And the first of 3 points that I want to share in our Bible study as we dig in Ephesians chapter 6 is it does not always feel good to be worked on. Isn't that right? It does not always feel good to be worked on. Ephesians chapter 6 starts off with Paul encouraging us to follow God's way and God's teaching, as what was mentioned in Sabbath school. He shares that we ought to obey God's commandments and even quotes the 5th commandment in reference to them. Paul encourages for slave and master to do the will of God, not pleasing others, but seeking only to please God. In Ephesians chapter 6. And in verse 8 is where I want you to read with me. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 8 is where we're going to start with our scripture reading. And here in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 8, listen to what Paul says. Knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive the same from the Lord, whether he is a slave or free. Knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive from the Lord, the same from the Lord, whether he is slave or free. I remember when I was reading this portion of scripture, a little thought came into my head that I could not shake. And the thought was simply this: if I do good, then somehow, some way, I'm owed good. If I do good, I am owed good. Somehow, some way, I came to think that when I read this scripture, I said, well, if I do good, then the same is going to come to me from the Lord. Somehow, some way, I thought that by being good or doing good, that it would put a hedge of protection around me from the deep disappointments of life. Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever struggled with the idea of why it is that God allows certain things to happen to people who seemingly don't deserve it? Now, I know that at surface level, most of us have heard Most of us don't follow that line of thinking, and that most of us have heard of the theme of the great controversy. And what is the great controversy? The great controversy is the theological perspective of a real God having conflict with a real Satan. And that somewhere in between, our lives are affected by the war or the conflict that is going on between good and evil. It's about the unseen war between God and Satan. Good things are supposed to happen to good people, but is that really so? I thought I was a staunch believer in God's promises and goodness. I thought I was most definitely not the one to ever question God's dealings in my life. In fact, when certain people used to share with me some of the issues that they were going through, I would be quick to quote a familiar Bible verse. Romans 8:28, right? I would always quote that Bible verse to my friends who were struggling in some way, shape, or form. For all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. Don't worry, Bob. Just trust God. And everything will work out fine. I used to share. And intellectually, we know these verses. Isn't that right? We grew up singing about these verses. So when the rubber meets the road and we think that we would have steadfast faith to the point that we are discouraged and falling apart, we're too ashamed to even share it with others. Because we know the Bible verses. We've read the Bible stories. We've sung the biblical songs. So why is it that my faith is being shaken? And we try to hide it to make sure that people at church don't know how weak I really am. One of the most honest places I've ever been to has been Alcoholics Anonymous. Not sure if anyone has ever ventured into those doors, but I did 365 meetings in 365 days once upon a time. Definitely not a feat that I'd like to proclaim too loudly, but that's what I did. But I would never forget what I saw in the rooms of AA. When someone was first introduced to the group. Do you want to know how they're introduced to the whole body of group, for the whole group? This is what they share. Hi, my name is Marco, and I'm an alcoholic. It's almost like they know in their minds that if you are in those rooms, you know you got a problem. People don't go to AA just for a date night or to meet new friends or to try to find a hot date. You'll get more than what you bargain for if you go in there for that. You go there because you know you have a what? A problem. I never went there just to hang out. In fact, when I did 365 meetings in 365 days, it wasn't even out of my own free will. It was because a judge told me, if you don't do this, I'm going to send you to jail. And I thought to myself, well, AA jail, they at least got cookies and coffee. I'll go to AA. And guess what? It was even more surprising when I saw people in AA. What was more surprising was when you saw people who had backslidden. Someone who had fallen back into alcohol after being sober for whatever amount of time. Do you know what I noticed when someone had backslidden in AA? They would raise their hand. They say, hey, my name is Bob. I'm an alcoholic. I had been sober for 62 days. But this past weekend, something happened and a craving came up and I called my sponsor, but he didn't answer. So I ended up drinking. Can you imagine that? An alcoholic that drank? Just when the rocks were about to be cast upon him for falling back into his sin, do you know what everybody in AA would do? They would get up. It's almost like the whole room would just roar. They would all stand up. They would clap their hands and they would say, "Thank goodness that you are here this morning." Just imagine. Just imagine what church would be like if we had that type of authenticity in front of all of us. Being authentic. Let's not try to pretend we're anything different than AA friends. If we are sitting in church today, you better believe it's because you know that you have a problem. And that without church and without God, you are no better than anybody else here in this city. Just imagine if we would treat each other in the same way when someone backslid into sin. Where instead of talking about it at Pollock, "Hey, do you know what Mr. So-and-so did? Oh, children out of wedlock. Can't believe that, you know." Just imagine if instead of doing that, we embrace the brother or sister who had fallen into sin and saying, "Praise God, thank goodness that you are sitting here this morning." But oftentimes we try to put up a facade that we have it all together. And sometimes we actually get people to believe us because on Saturday morning is when I put on my best clothes. And I smell the best too. Imagine how this place would be like with by being authentic to one another and not trying to pretend that we are anything we're not. Let's face it, friends. We're all sinners. We all struggle with a sinful nature. We all do things that we're not proud of and say things we're not proud of and are plagued by thoughts we're not proud of. But we know that there is power in the blood of Jesus. We know that his blood has forgiven our sins. We know that his Holy Spirit, who now reigns in us, gives us power over those tendencies. But let's not try to pretend that we do this on our own. Let's embrace the reality that we're nothing without Jesus. That we're nothing without God. And that just because someone falls into sin, just because someone falls into something they're not proud of, that doesn't define them. What defines them is that they are still a son or daughter of God. The devil is a schemer. I love the Christian journey because sanctification is all about growth, isn't it? No two moments are alike when you're walking with Christ. He is constantly working things out in our lives. Whether you've been baptized for 10 years or for 53 years, he's not done working. And he's going to continue to work until he returns. And sometimes the workings that he does in our lives, sometimes it feels good, but most times it doesn't. Sometimes you understand why he's working in your life the way he is, but sometimes you're left in the dark as to why he allows certain things to touch you. Sometimes you see the good being worked out, and sometimes you're clueless as to why God would allow something like this to come into my life. But we learn a powerful lesson in Isaiah chapter 55. Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 55. The prophet shares a powerful lesson. We're still discussing the point of it doesn't always feel good to be worked on. Are we in Isaiah 55, friends? Starting in verse 8, Isaiah 55, starting in verse 8, the word of God reads the following. This is through the prophet Isaiah. And this is what he says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. We can pretend to know the processes of God, but it takes the God of the process to actually know what he is doing. So when you can't figure something out in your life, when something seems very vague and you're not really understanding why God works the way he does in your life, welcome to the club. Because there are moments in our faith where we all come to that position where there are things happening that wish that weren't happening, and we are left with questions. We are left with a curiosity as to why God does what he does. Isaiah let us know in this book that his thoughts are not our thoughts, and that his ways are not our ways. He has 1,000 ways to supply what we need, friends, which we know nothing of. And then he points to nature. There is something about nature that is fascinating, that teaches us to see the bigger picture. I just read an article yesterday on the news that talked about how there is a huge storm coming to Northern California. 12 inches of snow are expected up in the mountains, and they're just very thankful because the snow would then provide water later. The bigger picture. Nature teaches us how to see the bigger picture. It shows us that the mountaintop full of snow will eventually melt and feed the streams that feed the waters that give life to everything that it passes. It teaches us that the sun's rays are not all about light, but about giving life to plants and trees that give off their life-giving oxygen to the rest of us. There are many things in nature that speak upon this matter, but Isaiah continues in chapter 55 in verse 10, and he says something really interesting. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven and does not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth in bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the things for which I have sent it. Nature does its thing, whether you take time to understand it or not. Nature will continue to work for the benefit of others, even if you don't understand the process. The process will come around full circle, even if you're still stuck trying to figure out how the snow got on the mountain. You don't actually know how that little seed that eventually becomes a tree, that eventually becomes a fruit, that eventually becomes food, how it got there. But it does not mean you do not enjoy the meal. God has promised that his word will bring back fruit, especially the fruit that it intended in your life. Are you waiting for Jesus to come, friends? God is working in you. He's working on you. He's perfecting the beauty, the apple of his eye. And life circumstances takes us to take journeys at times that are confusing. But they don't happen just by chance. It will work out what it needs to work out in you, even if you don't understand the process. We don't understand all the workings of nature, but it does not mean that nature is not at work. And in so like manner, God's workings are not always the clearest, but it does not mean that God is not at work. And finally, Isaiah tells us in verse 12, "For you shall go out with joy and be led out with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth into singing before you." Have you ever seen that? "The mountains and the hills shall break forth into singing before you, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree, and it shall be to the Lord for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. The very thing that is bringing unrest, the very thing that is leading you to be confused, will be the very thing that if you just hold on to the hand of Jesus, it'll be the very thing that leads you to experience peace. Have you experienced that before? If you just give it time and you're able to look back and you're able to see that one of the darkest seasons of your life was meant to bring the greatest light. It happens. I was in a car wreck in 2009 where a young man died. Could not believe it. Could not understand it. But if I really trace my faith journey, it was on his life that was ended that my faith really started taking its journey. And now my son is named after him as a reminder of when it all started, Abraham. If nature can praise God, surely I can praise God too. Isn't that right? If the trees can clap their hands, how can we not clap our hands as well? And Paul then says in Ephesians chapter 6, if you can go back there with me. Paul then says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, this is what he says. We read it for our scripture reading. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the, what's that word, friends? Against the wiles of the devil. Some versions say the schemings of the devil. Which leads us to our second point this morning. The devil is a schemer. Not sure if you ever heard it like that, but the devil is a schemer. Right here in scripture. And what's a schemer? The verb scheme means to make plans, especially in a devious way or with an intent to do something illegal or wrong. As a noun, it means a large-scale systematic plan or arrangement for attaining a particular object or putting a particular idea into effect. The word in the original is methodia, which is related to trickery. The devil works by trickery. He never works in a way that's apparent that he is working, but he is always working in a way that conceals him and his motives. I'm not sure if you're starting to see the picture yet, but the devil does not play by the rules. Satan hardly ever works in the light. He always works in the crevices and always works in the shadows. He's too smart to work outright in your life. He knows that you would just run to the prayer closet, run to your prayer group, if that was the case. Instead, he would rather work in such a way where you don't even know he's working. He's done this in scripture since the fall. He showed up as the most beautiful creature in the Garden of Eden. He showed up in envy and anger in the first murder that took the life of Abel. He showed up as a harlot to the children of Israel to get them to break their allegiance to God. He showed himself as a raiding band in acts of nature against Job and his family. He suggested lustful thoughts to David as he saw a woman taking a shower. He reveals himself to Christ in the wilderness when he is suffering from hunger as an angel of light. Time and time again, Satan comes as a schemer with one purpose in mind, and that purpose is to destroy their faith. When the devil is scheming against you, it's the same purpose. He really does not want anything else other than your commitment to God. It was never about fruit. It was never about an offering from the ground. It was never about sex out of wedlock. It was never about children and livelihood being destroyed. It was never about a woman taking a shower. It was never about hunger pains in the desert. These were the schemes of the devil to get God's people to break their allegiance from him. The devil is a schemer. He's not just after your physical body. That's too easy. He wants your soul. He wants your soul. I feel that's the reason why we read in Paul's counsel in the following verses in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 and 13, where he says, "For we do not wrestle." You've read this many times before, friends. "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and against powers and against rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand." Paul understood that the conflicts that the Christian is to have on this earth were much deeper than what was to the naked eye. And he goes on to say in verse 16, he goes on to say, "Above all, taking the shield of faith." What does "above all" mean? More than anything I've just mentioned, more than the girdle, more than the breastplate, more than all of that, "above all, taking the shield of faith, which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one." And why "above all"? Simply put, the devil works so well that there are times in our faith where it is only because of faith that we are still standing. Because your heart is telling you not to stand. Your mind is telling you to run the different direction. But faith, and faith alone, is what keeps you there. It happened to Jesus when he was on the cross, friends. When everyone had betrayed the Son of God, and he was breathing his last breaths, and he was on that cross by himself. His own heart was betraying him. My God, why have you forsaken me?" But it was faith that kept him on the cross. And it is faith that will keep you standing when everything around you is telling you to give up. Above all, 14 months ago is the sweetest and most bitter moment of my life. Sweetest because I got to meet my son for the first time. Bitter because I was also told that he was born with Down syndrome. My schedule was already full to preach almost every single weekend. But my faith was shaken. What does every parent pray for when you know that your wife is pregnant? What does every parent pray for? For a healthy baby. Every parent prays for that. And I prayed for that too. And when we were told that something didn't look quite normal at about 30 months, you better believe I was praying for that even more. I have never, ever fasted the way I fasted and prayed during that time leading up to her birth. And it was weird because whenever I fast, even to this day, whenever I fast, I'm like counting down until I have my next meal. Right? Blood sugar drops, got headaches, you know. But when I fasted for my son, I've never fasted that long before. And the crazy thing about it is I never even felt hunger during that fast. It was different. So when my son was born and I was told the news that he had a disability, it rocked and shocked my world. I sat down with my wife one morning and I said, "Honey, I don't know if I can continue preaching. I don't know if I can continue preaching. It's hard for me to tell people to trust God when I myself am struggling to trust Him." We know the Christian thing to do is to have faith, amen? I knew verses of Romans 8:28, and I knew all of those verses, and I read all those promises in the spirit of prophecy, and it was all just head knowledge until the rubber met the road. I had people who would come to my house to try to encourage me, and they just left me more discouraged by the time they left. One of the most difficult years of my life. I couldn't see the end of the tunnel. In fact, the only reason I'm here in front of you was because of what Paul was telling us in Ephesians 6. Above all, you need faith. Because there are some things that will happen, if they haven't already, in your life that will leave you with some serious questions, that will seek to destroy the faith that you have. Diagnosis that will come to you, despite, by God's grace, following the principles of health that we have. Children that will hurt you, despite raising them in church and doing everything you could to teach them about God. And in those moments of deepest darkness, when nothing makes sense, above all, have faith enough to just remain there, to stay there until God chooses to give you more light. The last 3 months have been incredible. When I see my son, I don't see a son that has a genetic disposition. I see the sweetest child I have ever known. And I told my wife recently, I said, "Honey, the crazy part about this whole journey that we've been on this last year is that I wouldn't want any other son in my life. If you knew truly what I went through that year, you would know that those words were a miracle. And I wish that Abraham was here so that you can meet him. He is something else. And I'm not just saying that because he came from me." Last two things I'll share with you and we're done. Ministry of Healing said the following. Page 478. "God never leads his children otherwise than they would choose to be led if they could see the end from the beginning." Whew. God never leads his children otherwise than they themselves would choose to be led if they could see the end from the beginning. Beautiful. And the last thing I'll share with you, by a Christian philosopher by the name of Soren Kierkegaard. He shared, "Life can only be understood backwards, but it must be lived forward." I came here this morning simply to encourage someone that may be going through a season where not much is making sense. Welcome to the club. We all go through those seasons. But I want to encourage you to stay put. Stay put. Have faith. trust Jesus, that he has your best intention in mind. You see, when I look back at what happened this last year in context of what we shared from Ephesians chapter 6, I know that my son being born the way he was is much bigger than a genetic disposition. I know that the devil is a schemer. And more than anything, he wanted my faith. And he wanted the faith of my wife. But by God's grace, we are still standing. And I want to encourage you to still stand. And even if it's dark right now, understand that it's not dark for God. Even if you can't see the end right now, understand that God already sees it and he will make a way of escape. Even if it doesn't seem like a blessing, understand that that which you are going through, God will use to make and shape you in the person that he's created you to be. So stay faithful, stay standing. Jesus will help us through. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you so much for loving us. Thank you so much for holding our hands through tough seasons. Thank you so much for your example, for Christ himself went through some difficult moments in his life. And just as he remained faithful and received his reward, I know for a fact, Lord, that we will receive our reward too when you come again and you make all things right. Come, Lord Jesus, please come. In Jesus' name, amen.